If you're a visitor with us, please grab a connection card, place it in the collection plate as it comes along. Our song leader this morning will be Uncle David. But let me read this morning's scripture from Ephesians 4, 11 and 12. You may have heard this one once before. And he gave us the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the shepherds, and teachers to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, as we come to you this morning, let us first thank you for everyone to be here, dear Lord. Thank you for this beautiful day you have given us. Thank you for the time and the ability to worship you in the fashion that you desire. Please be with us through this worship service, that we may embody you and that we may do everything in your name. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's please stand for our first song, hymn number 704. I'll start it out while the song leader comes up here. Bind us together, Lord, bind us together with hearts that cannot be broken. Bind us together, Lord, bind us together, Lord, bind us together with love. There is only one God, there is only one King, there is only one body. That's why we can sing. Bind us together, Lord, bind us together with cords cannot be broken. Bind us together, bind us together, Lord, bind us together with love. Please be seated. Hymn number 488. Into the heart of Jesus, deeper and deeper I go, seeking to know the reason why he should love me so. Why he should stoop to lift me up from the miry clay, saving my soul, making me whole, though I had wandered away. Into the will of Jesus, deeper and deeper I go, praying for grace to know for you, seeking his way to know, bowing in full surrender, low at his blessed feet, bidding him take, break me and make, till I am molded and meet. Into the cross of Jesus, deeper and deeper I go, following through the garden, facing the dreaded foe, drinking the cup of sorrow, sobbing with broken heart. Oh, Savior, help, dear Savior, help, grace for my weakness impart. Into the joy of Jesus, deeper and deeper I go, rising with souls enraptured, far from the world below. Joy in the place of sorrow, peace in the midst of pain. Jesus will give, Jesus will give, he will uphold and sustain. 792.
This will be to him before our prayer.
My eyes are dry, my faith is old, my heart is hard, my prayers are cold, and I know how I ought to be alive to you and dead to me. What can be done to an old heart like mine? Soften it up with oil and wine. The oil is you, your spirit of love. Please wash me anew in the wine of your blood.
Let us pray. Our dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the opportunity we have to come here and to worship you, Father. We just ask you to be with us this morning, that our worship will be pleasing to you and is according to your will and how you want to be worshiped and how you want to be praised. Father, we just thank you for each and every person here. We thank you for each and every family. We ask for your blessings on all of us as we are at different places and different times in our lives and in our walk with you, Father, that we can continue to grow closer to you, to build our faith, to refine our faith, to face the challenges of this world, the tests that we face in our life, the temptations that we face, that we can always keep our eyes focused on you, that we can always have an attitude of being ready to serve those who are around us. And Father, we know that we need your help and your strength and each other's encouragement to do that. Father, at this time, I want to ask you to be with Kerry Terry as he's on his way here. This coming weekend, and he's going to be with us next week for our gospel meeting. Just to ask you that you be with him, that you bless his travel, and most of all, his messages that he's bringing to us. We just ask that we be encouraged by that, and that once again our faith grows by that, and that we take that opportunity to grow and to learn more about you, Father. We ask you to be with our small groups. Help them to be a blessing to all those who are involved as well. Father, we thank you for the safe travel that our teens had this past week, going to and from Nashville to learn more about how your work and how your service is being carried out in other parts of the country. Father, we ask you to be with us through this service. We ask you to be with all those who have a leadership role in it, that they may lead our hearts and our minds in a way that pleases you. Father, as always, we ask you to forgive us of our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Three hundred forty-six. This will be our hymn before we have the Lord's Supper.
I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. I know that he is living, whatever men may say. I see his hand of mercy. I hear his voice of cheer. And just the time I need him, he's always near. He lives, he lives. Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, he lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives. He lives within my heart. In all the world around me, I see his loving care. I know that he is leading through all the stormy blast. The day of his appearing will come at last. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me, talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives. He lives within my heart. Rejoice, rejoice, O Christian, lift up your voice and sing. Eternal alleluias to Jesus Christ the King, the hope of all who seek him. None other is so loving, so good and kind. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives. He lives within my heart.
Good morning. We come here each first day of the week to remember our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We partake of the bread, which represents his body, the cup that represents the blood of the new covenant that he spilled for us. We also read in the Bible, we read in God's word that Jesus emptied himself of all heavenly splendor to come in the form of a servant. And lately we've been talking about how we can serve God ourselves. We can look at our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, how he ultimately served God, and his whole desire was to serve God and to fulfill God's promise to us and to fulfill God's word through giving himself as a living sacrifice for us, that we could have forgiveness of our sins, and that he gave himself completely to even die on the cross for us. Let us remember our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ at this time as we partake of the bread. We'll ask Brother Julio to pray for it.
Father God, we are grateful that you allow us this day, Father, to gather around your table to remember the sacrifice of your Son, Jesus. At this time, Father, as we take the bread that represents his body, we pray that we do so in a manner that is pleasing to you, Lord. We do this in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen.
Let's pray. Our Father, we are thankful for this day that we can come and gather around this table with brothers and sisters in Christ. We pray as we partake the cup, we see it as a symbol of Christ's blood that was shed on the cross, that we may have the hope of eternal life. We ask that we give all glory and honor to you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let's pray. Dear God, at this time we come to you, asking you to bless this offering that we're about to give. Bless us, Lord, as we give back a portion of what you have so richly blessed us with. Be with the men and the leadership of the congregation that this money could be used to best spread your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
The next two songs we're going to sing before we have our lesson today will describe what we were before Christ and as we entered being a Christian. And then the last one will emphasize what the end result of being a Christian is. 517.
Oh, what a wonderful, wonderful day, day I will never forget. After I've wandered in darkness away, Jesus, my Savior, I met. Oh, what a tender, compassionate friend, he met the need of my heart. Shadows dispelling with joy, I am telling, he made all the darkness depart. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. When at the cross the Savior made me whole. My sins were washed away and my night was turned to day. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. Born of the Spirit with life from above, into God's family divine, justified fully through Calvary's love, oh, what a standing is mine. When as a sinner I came, took of the offer of grace he did proffer, he saved me, oh, praise his dear name. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. When at the cross the Savior made me whole. Sins were washed away and my night was turned to day. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. Now I have a hope that will surely endure after the passing of time. I have a future in heaven for sure, there in those mansions sublime. And it's because of that wonderful day when at the cross I believed, riches eternal and blessings supernal from his precious hand I received. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. When at the cross the Savior made me whole. Sins were washed away, turned to day. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. Let us stand, please. Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing his mercy and his grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, he'll prepare for us a place. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Let us then be true, trusting, serving every day. Just one glimpse of him in glory will the toils of life repay. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Please be seated.
Good morning. It's good to see all of you here this morning, especially after last week where I know a lot of people were snowed in. But it's good to see that we've been able to get out today and are here with us this morning. I wanted to start this morning with a quote. And it is, "The end is reconciliation. The end is redemption. The end is the creation of the beloved community. It is the type of spirit and this type of love that can transform opposers into friends. The type of love that I stress here is not eros, a sort of aesthetic or romantic love, not philia, a sort of reciprocal love between personal friends, but it is agape, which is understanding, goodwill for all men. It is an overflowing love which seeks nothing in return. It is the love of God working in the lives of men. This is the love that may well be the salvation of our civilization."
That quote, if you don't know it, is from Dr. Martin Luther King. Tomorrow, as a country, we will be celebrating Martin Luther King Day. And one of the things that normally occurs on Martin Luther King Day across the country is there are things called days of service, where groups get together and they perform acts of service. They clean up a park, they visit those that are sick or in need, but they do acts of servitude towards their community, which I thought was appropriate to talk about, given our theme is Ready for Service. So one thing I want to talk about this morning, and it is in response to this quote, is the idea of the beloved community. And I want to talk specifically how the idea and the creation of a beloved community lends itself to service. And how if we're going to be a beloved community, if we're going to be a community that loves each other, how that's something that will show up in how we serve. And I think that is something we should focus on, something we should try to create. A community that loves each other is something we should strive for as a church. So I'm going to start today in John chapter 13. We're going to start in verse 34. We're going to move a little bit around in John chapter 13. We're going to start at verse 34 and read 34 and 35. A lot of people look behind me, so I'm like, is it up there? I'm not sure. I need a mirror in the back, Don. Can we get that? So in John chapter 13, verses 34 and 35, it says, "A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another, even as I have loved you, that you love one another. By this all men will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." So Jesus here gives the command to his apostles. This is at the Last Supper, where he has instituted earlier in this chapter the Lord's Supper. And Jesus says, "This new commandment I give to you, that you love one another." And he says, this is how you're to be known. This is how people are to know you, by your love for one another. I thought about this, and I thought about how people are known as something. And I think if we think about our groups of friends, or maybe the people we work with, there's the sports guy, or there's the math guy, or there's the one who always corrects people's grammar. You know, people are known by something. People are typically, oh yeah, that's the guy that always has a mint. You know, they're known for something. And Jesus here is saying that we should be known as people who love one another. And I think this is this idea of being known by something isn't foreign to gospel times that occurred as well in biblical times. If you think about Barnabas, whose real name was Joseph, but why was he called Barnabas? Because he was the son of encouragement. He was such an encourager that they changed the name they called him to Son of Encouragement. People are known by something. They're known for something. And Jesus says that as his disciples, as the people that follow him, we're to be known as people who love one another. I don't think it's surprising here that the word that Jesus uses here is agape. It's that word that Martin Luther King says will be the salvation of our civilization, that type of selfless love. Jesus wants us to be known as the people that, oh, that church, that's the one that really loves one another and loves other people. Embedded in that command in verse 34, he says, "Even as I have loved you." Jesus showed them how to love. He showed them what that love looked like. And he hadn't just shown it throughout his ministry, but he had just shown it to them. So if you turn back in chapter 13 to verse 12, Jesus had just performed an act. He had just washed the apostles' feet. And in verse 12, he says, "So when he had washed their feet and taken his garments and reclined at the table again, he said to them, 'Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for so I am. If I then, the Lord and teacher, wash your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet.'" It's interesting to me that after Jesus gets done with this, he sits down back at the table. He goes, "Do you realize what just happened? Do you understand what just occurred?" He says, "If I am Lord and Master, and you are right in saying that, what did I just do?" He just washed their feet. It was custom in that time for the host to typically give water for their visitors to wash their own feet, and sometimes they would even give a servant
to wash their feet. It was extremely uncommon for the host or the lord or the master of that particular place to actually do that. The only other time that we were looking through, trying to find some other examples of this, in 1 Samuel 13, there is an example of Abigail washing the feet of the messengers of David. And that was a humbling experience for her. That was to show that they were honored in her sight. But typically, it was a servant that did that. So Jesus here is saying, do you realize what I just did? The Lord, the Master, the teacher that you call me, I humbled myself and served you. A couple weeks ago, when Dave was speaking about humility, as we kicked off this series, or as we kicked off the theme, he talked about how humility plays a part in service, how putting others above yourself is essential if we want to have a heart of service. And I think Jesus here is reiterating that, but he adds a little something to it, and hopefully I can add a little something as well, what he's talking about here. So if you continue on in verse 15, it says, "For I gave you an example that you should do as I did to you. Truly, truly, I say to you, a slave is not greater than his master, nor is one who is sent greater than the one who sent him. If you know these things, you are blessed if you do them." Jesus flat out tells them, this is an example you're to follow. Oftentimes, we look at the life of Jesus, we see the things he has done, and we say, that's an example for us. That's something we're to follow. Here, he specifically says, this is an example you're to follow. There's no reading into that. He tells us that if we are to follow him, if we are to be disciples of him, we are to serve. We are to humble ourselves. We are to put others ahead of us. Jesus also served with humility, and I think that's an important way for us to think about service. That service, true service, Christian service, Jesus' service, didn't come out of pity. It wasn't because he felt bad for the people around the table. He didn't do it out of obligation. He didn't feel like he had to do it. He did it because he was humble and out of love. And in response, if we turn over to Matthew chapter 20, there's a situation there where the mother of John and James asked Jesus, when he returns in his glory, to put one at the right and one at the left. And in Matthew 20, verses 26 through 28, He tells them, you don't know what you're asking for. He tells them, are you ready to drink the cup? They say they are. And then in Matthew 20, 26 to 28, it says, it is not this way among you, but whoever wishes to become great among you shall be your servant, and whoever wishes to be first among you shall be your slave, just as the Son of Man did not come to serve, but to be served, and to give his life as a ransom for many. So Jesus performs this act in John chapter 13, and then later on, he says, to love each other even as I have loved you. I think what Jesus is commanding here is we're to have a humble, loving service, which expects nothing in return, which is what Martin Luther King was talking about with a agape love, which is a service that expects nothing. I think that's what Jesus' service looked like as well. And this is not only a steep call, not only a difficult call to follow, to have a humble and loving attitude towards service, but it's also a rarely answered one. If you look at society, there's very few that are willing to humble themselves and to love so much to serve without expecting anything in return. I read a very interesting article this past week, and it was talking about millennial parents. And it was giving some statistics, and I think, Troy, actually, you shared it first, because my wife shared it, and then I read it. But it was really interesting, and it was talking about, you know, if you look at the age group of millennials, that's 23 to 38, and those are the ones with young kids right now. Millennials are the ones that are having children and are raising children. And it talked about how millennial parents not going to church is a major reason why nurseries across the country are empty. Or barren, or there's only a few kids in them. I think if any of us have been around the church for a long time, we've seen full nurseries. We've seen where there was an abundance of kids in the congregation, not only here, but across the country. But that's not the case now. Some statistics to back that up, only 2 in 10 of people under 30 believe attending church is important. 59% of millennials raised going to church have dropped out. I think we've seen that number here. I remember my youth group. If you think back, I was in a youth group of about 12 to 14 kids. Christina moved away, so we'll give her an excuse. But I look around and I don't see those same people anymore. And that's true across countries. 59% have dropped out. 35% of millennials have an anti-church stance, believing that church and religion does more harm than good. If you've talked to many people, you've probably heard this, that religion causes wars, religion causes animosity, religion causes hate. And that's an opinion that has become prevalent, especially within my age group. And the article presented some interesting ways to combat that, some interesting ways to try to fix it. One that stood out to me in particular with this subject matter in mind, and I may bring up others later, said we need to walk the walk, not just talk the talk. And I think about my age group, and I think about the way we were raised to think. We were raised in the internet age. We saw everything. We had an abundance of information, and we were told consistently that we were able to change the world. We were able to make a difference because technology allows me to reach people anywhere. I could walk out of here, call somebody in China, and talk to them about business or about religion or about politics. This interconnectivity has been entrenched in our society, especially with my age group. And it says we need to walk the walk, not just talk the talk. And it said that millennials are not just interested in seeing a church merely exist. They're not okay with it just being here. They need it to do something. They need to see action. And that's how they will feel engaged and want to be a part of that activity. And the church definitely has the ability to do that. The church has the ability to change the world. Throughout history, the church has changed the world. But we have to be willing to show people that we're willing to get out there and do it. We're willing to get out there and serve. And when we serve in the appropriate way, when we serve with humble and a loving attitude, I think that will change the world. It's easy to look at the numbers that I stated and get discouraged. It's easy, especially for me, to look at my contemporaries and say, well, they're just lost. It's easy to look at the young people and say, well, they're just a godless people. They don't care. Doesn't matter what we do, because this is their attitude. And I don't think that's a way we should look at things, because when you look throughout history, especially when you look at Acts, I remember when we studied Acts in the men's class on Wednesday nights, and it was fascinating to me how Paul, when he was talking to Athens and he was talking to Antioch, tailored his message to that people. It was all the truth. It was all God's word. But he met them where they were. And I think that's what we have to do if we want to reach people. We have to meet them where they are. And with that becomes a loving and humble service. If we want to reach people, if we want to get out there and show people that the church can make a difference, it comes through a humble and loving service. And when you think about why Paul did that, why did Paul tailor his message? Why didn't he just lay out the same sermon every time and say, look, it's up to them. I told them the truth. I told them what they had to do. It's up to them to respond, regardless of how I say it. And I think he tailored it because of his love for God and his love for people. Because he wanted to reach every single person. So he would try to reach them where they were, try to bring them up where they are, and bring them to the knowledge and love of God. So my response to, if we want to bring more people in, I think that we need to serve with love. And if we want to change the world, we need to serve everyone with love. If we want to follow the example of Jesus, we need to serve with love and humility. If we become that beloved community, if we become that vision that Martin Luther King laid out in that quote, that will look different. That will stand out. That will make a difference, and that will make people take notice. That's that church that loves everybody. That's that church that serves the community. I think that will help us to stand out. And after John chapter 13, when Jesus is talking, he talks to his disciples about many things. He continues to talk to them. He talks to them about his betrayal. He talks to them about his departure. He talks to them about the Spirit that would come to them. And then if you flip over to John chapter 15, in verse 12, he repeats this command to them. This is my commandment, that you love one another just as I have loved you. Again, speaking with that agape love, that selfless love that expects nothing in return, that sacrificial love. I think he repeats that command to them, not just because he forgot that he said it earlier, but he wanted to emphasize this. He wanted to say, this is how it should be known. Then he continues to talk and he says, look, this is my commandment, that you love one another, even as I have loved you. And Jesus loved them by serving them and by being a servant to them, because he didn't come into the world to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom to many, as we read in Matthew 20. So I think if we're looking this year and if we're ready to serve, I think if we have trouble thinking about, well, am I ready to serve? Am I ready to serve other people? Am I ready to serve as God has called me to? I think one of the things we need to reflect on and really think about is, how do we love? Are we loving other people as God has called us to love other people? Are we following the example of Jesus to love one another? Because if we are, I think we'll be ready for service. If we love as Jesus has loved, then we'll be ready to serve as he was ready to serve. And we come in contact with God's love and his mercy through baptism. The church is also here to love you. And in one moment, we'll stand and sing, and we'll give an opportunity to do that, to come forward if you need any prayers or if you want to join in and have contact with God's love through baptism. But I wanted to leave you with another quote. And again, it's from the same person. It's from Martin Luther King. It says, everybody can be great because anybody can serve. You don't have to have a college degree to serve. You don't have to make your subject and verb agree to serve. You only need a heart full of grace, a soul generated by love. Everybody can be great because anybody can serve in some capacity. All that you need is a heart full of grace and a soul generated by love. And if we can help you in any way this morning to do that, we encourage you to come forward as we stand and sing.
Troublesome times are here, filling men's hearts with fear. Freedom we all hold dear, now is at stake. Humbling your heart to God, safe from the chastening rod. Seek the way pilgrims from Christians away. Jesus is coming soon, morning or night or many will meet their doom. Trumpets will sound, all of the dead shall rise. Righteous meet in the sky. Where no one dies, heavenward bound. Love of so many cold, losing their homes of gold. This is God's word is told, evils abound. When these things come to pass, nearing the end, it will come very fast, trumpets will sound. Jesus is coming soon, morning or night horn. Many will meet their doom, trumpets will sound. All of the dead shall rise, righteous meet in the sky. Going where no one, heavenward bound. Troubles will soon be o'er, happy forever. When we meet on that shore, free from all care, rising up in the sky, telling the world goodbye. Homeward we then will fly, glory to share. Jesus is coming soon, morning or night horn. Many will meet their doom, trumpets will sound. All of the dead shall rise, righteous meet in the going where no one died, heavenward bound. Please be seated.
You have the announcement?
Okay. One more announcement that he doesn't have. This Saturday morning, Carrie Terry will be here. We will have breakfast at Britt's, a special Meet Carrie Terry breakfast. We will have a Devo, and we'll have breakfast supplied at over there at 8 o'clock. 8 o'clock. So you didn't have that. Okay.
Thank you, sir, for that wonderful announcement. Good morning, everybody. It's good to see everybody here. We'll go over a few things. If you do not have a bulletin, please pick one up in the back. There's quite a few things in there that I might miss. It's normal. And then I have a couple other things I have to add to it. The calendar, the tentative calendar for January through June is ready. We're still accepting input for July through December's calendar. Teen news, the teens have returned safely. That's a good thing. There's no Devo today. January 20th is a congregational meeting. Following morning worship, please plan to stay. January 27th through January 30th is gospel meeting with Carrie Terry each evening at 6:30. The lessons will be centered on Ephesians 4 through 12. To add to that, that means the teens bonfire is going to be canceled, but it'll be rescheduled for February 3rd. January 27th, potluck fellowship meal. For that meal, the theme will be healthy foods. Sign-up sheet is on the bulletin board. No carbs. No, I'm just kidding. keep all the people. Yeah, bring your own carbs. keep all the people on the prayer list in your prayers. There will be a Super Bowl party at Phil and Kathy's on February 3rd. Devo is at 5 for all small groups, if your groups would like to join us. Super Bowl to follow, bring favorite finger foods. Hopefully there will be a certain team in that Super Bowl that we all can enjoy, that we can cheer for today. Thank you. Okay, right after the prayer, we'll have a congregational meeting. All right, let's pray. Oh, I'm sorry. Does anybody have anything? Go. It's never a good thing. Yes, ma'am. Yeah, Dave.
Carrie texted me yesterday, last night, wanted to make sure I told everyone he's very excited to come and can't wait to see everyone again. So I just want to pass that along. He's excited about seeing everybody. So.
Yeah, Rhonda. Sean, you got anything? Yeah. All right, let's pray. Dear Holy, Righteous, Heavenly Father, Lord, we love you. Thank you for the blessing you've given us, allowing us to come here today to worship you, to learn more about your word, to strive to become a better servant through love and understanding. Lord, we ask to be with those who are struggling at this time with loss of loved ones, and it's a tough time for them. Give them strength and help them to try to understand what your will is. And we know your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And Lord, please be with those who are traveling, that they get their destination back safely. Please be with us that we continue to go off from the church building and try to become a better servant, to be mindful of what you want us to do, to live as a holy and living sacrifice for you. These things we pray through your Son, Jesus. Amen.